Specialist in obstetrics and gynecology. He's a fellow of the Royal College of Obstetricians and Gynecology. He's an MRCP from Ireland. And currently he's a professor in obstetrics and gynecology attached to the University of Colombo. He has many interests. Research interests, and he's a well-known academic, and I don't want to recite all his publications for the want of time. May I introduce Professor Athula Kaluarachchi to deliver the 2018 Dr. Siva Chinnathamby Oration.
President, Professor Deshabandu, members of the council, family members of late Deshabandu, Dr. Siva Chinnathamby, fellows and members of the college, honored guests, ladies and gentlemen. At the outset, let me thank the president and the council for selecting me to deliver the Deshabandu Siva Chinnathamby Oration for the year 2018. Siva Chinnathamby was born on 8th April 1920 and she was educated at Kaviti Saraswati Vidyalaya and Ramanagar Girls School. She graduated from medical school Colombo in 1946, and following her overseas training, she returned to Ceylon as a specialist in 1953. She was a founder member of the Family Planning Association of Sri Lanka, later its medical director, the post she held for nearly 25 years. During this period, she was able to organize an international family planning congress with participation of many world authorities. In 1960, after a visit by Gregory Hinkle, who was a co-inventor of the pill, the oral contraceptive pill, she started a trial on the pill, thus making Sri Lanka the first Asian country to use the oral contraceptive pill. She played an active role in the formation of the Association of Obstetricians and Gynaecologists of Ceylon in 1953 and held the post of secretary, treasurer and editor for many occasions. When the Sri Lanka College of Obstetricians and Gynaecologists was established in 1967, she was elected to the post of secretary, which she held for many years. During her tenure as the president of the SSCOG from 1983 to 1985, Sri Lanka was privileged to host the 10th Congress of Asia, Oceania and Federation of Obstetricians and Gynecologists in 1985. From 1987 to 1989, she was the president of the Asia-Oceania Federation of Obstetricians and Gynecologists as its first woman president. The Federation recognized her contribution by bestowing the honorary fellowship, making her the first Sri Lankan to receive such honor. She was awarded the honorary fellowship of the Royal Australian and New Zealand College of Obstetricians and Gynecologists as well. In recognition of her services to the nation, the prestigious Deshabandu Award was bestowed upon her in 1988. She passed away in year 2000, November, and after her demise, in year 2000, her residence at number 11 Neva Avenue, Colombo 7, was gifted to Colombo University to be used as a hostel for the female undergraduates studying at the University of Colombo. I deliver this oration to honor a great personality in our profession, and the topic I have selected is an area that she dedicated her services for decades. In my presentation, I would like to address the following area. A brief history of assisted reproduction, the process of in vitro fertilization and embryo transfer. And I will also touch on brief history of embryo freezing and different techniques of embryo freezing. And finally, present to you a study on the factors affecting the frozen embryo transfer in Sri Lanka. Assisted reproduction. The scientists were interested in the process of assisted reproduction way back in 1878 when a German scientist, W. Trink, attempted to fertilize rabbit eggs in the laboratory. Subsequently, in 1934, Regan Pinkers also was able to fertilize rabbit eggs in the laboratory. In 1944, John Rock from Harvard University mixed human eggs from cadavers with sperm and observed fertilization. In 1953, Landon Fietles fertilized human eggs to grow up to a solid mass of cells. In the year 1960, Dr. Chang performed in vitro fertilization and embryo transfer on a female rabbit and achieve a pregnancy. In the year 1961, an Italian physician, Daniel Petrucci, carried out a successful IVF with human egg and sperm, resulting in an embryo. And this was destroyed after 29 days due to tissue malformation. Since 1960, Robert Edwards was attempting in vitro fertilization using ova from oophorectomic specimens. At the same time, Patrick Steptoe, a gynecologist, was developing laparoscopy. The first IVF pregnancy was reported by Monash research team in 1973, which unfortunately was only a biochemical pregnancy. The next attempt at in vitro fertilization in 1976 was unfortunately an ectopic. Until finally in year 1978, the first IVF baby was born on 25th July 1978. And to this year, she is 40 years and a mother of two boys, which have resulted from spontaneous pregnancies. In vitro fertilization, an embryo transfer involves many steps. Basically, it involves pituitary downregulation, ovarian hyperstimulation to mature maximum amount of follicles, and you would collect eggs by aspiration of follicles, which are fertilized in the laboratory following sperm recovery and fertilized by one of two methods, either conventional in vitro fertilization or intracytoplasmic sperm injection, and the embryos will be transferred in a fresh cycle or they could be frozen. If they are transferred, a luteal support is given in progesterone. To achieve pituitary downregulation, you would use different protocols in the IVF setup. And the protocol you would use will depend on many factors, including the patient's age, the ovarian reserve, and investigation results of follicular stimulating hormone and anti-Müllerian hormone. Of course, the pelvic pathologies that have been existed also would be taken into consideration. Once a stimulation process is started, the follicle maturation is monitored using the ultrasound scan. As you see in this picture, you would expect ovarian hyperstimulation and to achieve many follicles from a patient to retrieve several eggs. The follicle aspiration is usually done under a local anesthetic with the approach of transvaginal scan, while monitoring on a screen, and a single channel needle or a double channel needle, which is used for flushing the follicles, is used to aspirate the follicle. Once the follicular fluid is aspirated, it will be sent off to the laboratory at keeping at 37 degrees Celsius, and it will be observed for the presence of ore. Once it reaches the laboratory, it will be selected under the microscope, and those eggs are washed and incubated prior to insemination. On the same day, the sperm sample is processed to retrieve good quality spermatozoa for insemination. The insemination is done using one or the other method, as I mentioned earlier, either using conventional in vitro fertilization, where you would use about 20,000 to 30,000 sperms around an egg and expect one sperm to enter the egg and get fertilized. When the sperm count is very low, insemination is performed by injecting a single sperm into the egg. Intracytoplasmic sperm injection, or ICSI, is performed using a micromanipulator. And at present, many centers perform intracytoplasmic sperm injection even with good sperm counts, since better fertilization is achieved with ICSI. Once the insemination is done in one or the other method, as I mentioned earlier, observation is made to see the pro-neoplasm state to assure that there is only one sperm have entered, and there is only two pro-nuclei. If more than one sperm has entered, it will be observed at that point, and those embryos has to be discarded, since the chromosome numbers are going to be abnormal. Once the embryos are fertilized and cell starts dividing to either two cell, egg cell, and even up to blastocyst, the embryos could be either frozen or transferred in the fresh cycle. The embryo transfer, if it is done in the fresh cycle, would be performed either on day 3 after the egg pickup, or day 5 in the blastocyst stage. The embryo transfer is usually done without any anesthetic, and this does not require any anesthesia, and the transfer is done like performing an intrauterine insemination. In certain situations, when you get many embryos, the embryos are not transferred either in the fresh cycle, or you may transfer one or two embryos, but you need to do something with the remaining ones without discarding. There are many reasons why an embryo may not be transferred in the fresh cycle. If there is a risk of ovarian hyperstimulation, if you require to postpone the embryo transfer in special circumstances, like not having a satisfactory endometrium, which is required for implantation, if you look at fertility preservation for future, so that you preserve the reproductive potential of women prior to treatment for various medical disorders or even malignancies. And there are many, although it is not common in Sri Lanka, there are many countries where women postpone having children to a late age because of their career, but would freeze their eggs or the embryos for future use. There are many clinical implications related to optimization of cryopreservation in vitro fertilization. In freezing embryos, at present, appears to have increased the cumulative birth rate. It helps you to freeze embryos or the eggs for future utilization or for donation in future. It permits fertility preservation for future use in case of medical disorders or malignancies. It gives you an opportunity for genetic diagnosis, and it gives you an opportunity to replace embryos as and when you require, rather than having to have a child on demand at a young age. The attempt at freezing embryos were attempted for many years, since 1970s. The initial embryo freezing with successful live warp frame was reported in 1972 with mouse eggs. And as you see in this slide, the animal eggs were frozen, and with successful implantations subsequently and having a live offspring long before the human embryo was frozen. The first reported human embryo freezing with a successful outcome was reported in 1963 from Melbourne, Australia, and it was reported in Nature in 1963. Unfortunately, this pregnancy continued only up to the stage of 24 weeks, and pregnancy was terminated because she developed sepsis. When you require embryo freezing, the fundamental objective of successful cryostorage of cells in liquid nitrogen at minus 196 degrees centigrade are as follows. You are required to arrest the metabolism in such a way that it is reversible. Once the embryo is frozen, it is important to maintain structural and the genetic integrity. The frozen embryo has to survive and should be able to come to life after killing, so that it maintains the development competence after the embryo is stored. And this technique, whatever you use for embryo freezing, has to be reliable and reproducible. The major difficulty of using low temperature cryo storage is that it can lead to crystallization of water with formation of ice, and thereby this approach can create unwanted physical and chemical events so that the frozen cells are injured. If it has ice formation, obviously there's expansion and cells could rupture. There are two main techniques that have developed for embryo freezing. One is the slow cooling technique, and the second is what's called rapid cooling technique or vitrification. Both methods of cryopreservation of biological material includes 6 basic principal steps. Initial exposure to a cryoprotectant where intracellular water is removed by gradual dehydration. Cooling the embryo to sub-zero temperatures to minus 196 degrees centigrade. Maintaining storage at very low temperature. And when you require to replace, there's gradual warming and thawing, and the dehydrated embryo has to be rehydrated. You are required to dilute and remove the cryoprotectant agents that you used initially to dehydrate the embryo. And you have to now put the embryo back into an environment that is physiological with different culture media. The slow freezing is usually done is by gradually decreasing the temperature. Embryos are processed, as I told you earlier, they are dehydrated in freezing media prior to freezing so that the cells are dehydrated. And embryos are frozen gradually, the temperatures are gradually brought down in the slow cooling technique so that the temperatures are brought down over a period of 1.5 to 2 hours, or sometimes even it might take longer. As you see in this slide, the slow freezing technique, once the cell is dehydrated, the temperatures are brought down gradually over a period of time to minus 196 degrees. And when it is required for thawing, it is taken out from the frozen state. It is rehydrated and subsequently kept in culture media for subsequent observation of cellular growth. As I told you earlier, the other method of freezing is called vitrification or rapid freezing. Rapid freezing involves, as compared to the slow freezing method, it involves rapidly freezing the embryo, even the temperature drop going up to about 3000 degrees centigrade per minute, and that is the kind or more, and that freezing is done very fast. As you see here, the cells which is dehydrated initially with cryoprotectant is rapidly cooled up to a degree of minus 196. And when you require to replace that embryo, there is rapid warming and subsequently replacing culture media so that the embryo becomes observed for viability and you will be able to transfer that embryo. And Here you see the time process for following the education. Once the towing process is done successfully, you would be observing either a compacted embryo, or it might even develop up to a blastocyst. Once it is confirmed that the same embryo is progressively developing, it can be transferred to the uterus of the woman once the endometrium is prepared adequately for receptive state of the embryo. Usually, the embryo transfer is done into the uterine cavity, to the upper two-thirds of the uterine cavity, and usually about a centimeter below the fundus of the uterus, and you could see the embryo being transferred under ultrasound guidance. And freezing and thawing and subsequent embryo transfer has become an essential part of in vitro fertilization and ICSI treatment, increasing the cumulative pregnancy rate after egg retrieval. It can be used for elective single embryo transfer so that the multiple birth rates are kept low and reduces the cost of neonatal care. It is important for us to understand the factors which could affect the success of frozen embryo transfer treatment cycles. The study is performed at a tertiary care reproductive health center in Sri Lanka to understand the factors that could affect the frozen embryo transfer success. We studied 366 frozen embryo replacement cycles during a period from 2012 to 2017, and data was collected from database retrospectively at this center. There were 227 embryo transfers done following slow freezing technique, and there were 139 done following vitrification. The freezing technique actually changed from year 2015. So all the embryos that were frozen before 2015 were done using the slow freezing technique, and after 2015 embryos were frozen using vitrification. The age distribution of the population that we studied showed there were about 50% of patients who have presented for in vitro fertilization treatment between the age of 30 and 35 years. Patients considering assisted reproduction at a younger age is a favorable trend. In the present analysis, only 6% of patients were over the age of 40 years. In the present study, the main reason for them to present for subfertility treatment was endometriosis followed by tubal factor infertility. There were a significant proportion of patients who have presented with male factor infertility. As I mentioned to you earlier, there were different protocols that have been adopted for induced ovarian hyperstimulation. The long down regulation protocol, the antagonist protocol, and the short protocol are the 2-3 protocols that are being used frequently. In this present study, we have used nearly 50% of the time the long down regulation protocol, followed by in about 35% of patients the antagonist protocol, and the rest being the short protocol. The slow cooling or the rapid cooling protocols both satisfy the fundamental cryobiological principles of reduction of damage by ice crystal formation during cooling and warm. The debate is what approach is better. As I mentioned to you earlier, we were able to compare the results from the different freezing techniques, since both techniques were used for this study. Prior to August 2015, the embryos were frozen using the slow freezing technique, and since August 2015, freezing technique was changed to vitrification. 227 frozen embryo transfers were performed using embryos frozen with slow freezing technique, while 139 were done with embryos frozen with vitrification. The main outcomes analyzed were the clinical pregnancy rate, which is the presence of clinical pregnancies with positive HCG, in relation to the number of procedures performed. And this could be reported either per cycle that was started, or per retrieval, or per embryo transfer. And the other outcome that was analyzed was the live birth rate. Again, this could be reported either per cycle, per retrieval, or for embryo transfer. When we looked at the outcome of the clinical pregnancies and the live birth rate according to freezing technique, the clinical pregnancy rate for vitrification, that is rapid freezing technique, was 56% with a live birth rate of 38.8, almost 40%. In the slow freezing technique, the clinical pregnancy rate was much lower with 38.8% and the live birth rate of 26%. This slide shows the clinical pregnancy rates based on two different techniques and the difference of success of clinical pregnancy rates, achieving clinical pregnancy rates, are statistically significantly different. Significant. When we looked at the live birth rates according to the freezing technique, again there was a significant difference in live birth rate depending on the freezing technique. The closed-loop freezing technique having a much lower success rate compared to vitrification. Even in the United States, where the Human Fertilization and Embryology Authority collects data from all over the country and reports every year, and according to their latest report, you could see at the bottom the embryo report of embryo transfer is recorded either for per embryo transfer or per treatment cycle. When you look at the success rate for per treatment cycle, it reaches around 30%. Although this is the average for United Kingdom, there are centers who are doing better and there are centers who are doing not so well. As I showed you earlier, even locally, we are capable or if you are able to maintain the standards and the quality of the laboratory, achieving the similar results and even better results is possible even in Sri Lanka. It is very well shown now, world over, that the slow freezing technique gives poor results when embryos are pre-frozen using the slow freezing technique, and the vitrification, which is the rapid freezing technique, gives much improved results. And there are several randomized trials suggesting that vitrification is superior. And this is the latest that has been published with a meta-analysis. Outcome of vitrification group was analyzed specifically, look at other factors like age, the type of subfertility, etiology of subfertility, the protocol used, the method of fertilization, and duration of freezing, and the endometrial thickness. All these factors shown in this slide, is one or the other, is known to perfect the success of frozen embryo transfer. When you looked at the age and the clinical pregnancy rate, it is a known factor, whatever the treatment that you use in infertility, age is the most important factor for success. And you can see, below the age of 35, if you are able to use treatment, your clinical pregnancy rates can reach even up to 60%. But as you go on, when you reach 35, 39, it drops to about 45%. And when you are above 39, it drops to about 29%. So there's a definite decline of your success of clinical pregnancies as well as live birth rates with increasing age. You see, the live birth rate reaches almost 50% when you are younger, below the age of 35. And this trend is seen all over the world. Even when you look at larger studies, analyzing multi-center studies using large samples, the trend of reducing success rate with increasing age is quite evident. You could see even in this study, when you are below the age of about 35, your success rate could reach almost up to about 60%. We looked at whether presenting with primary or secondary subfertility as an influence on the outcome. It is known that having a previous pregnancy is usually a positive factor for a successful outcome in in vitro fertilization. But when you looked at our analysis, there was no significant difference in the two groups with regard to etiology. So that is again is a positive factor to say you can achieve similar success rates using frozen embryo transfer irrespective of whether they have had a previous pregnancy or not. When you looked at their presentation for treatment with different etiological factors, here we looked at the male factor infertility, polycystic ovaries, endometriosis, tubal factor, and unintended infertility. This chart shows the success rates for clinical pregnancies and live birth rates in according to the different etiological factors. Although you see there are differences in the success rates depending on the etiological factors, these differences were not statistically significant. It is usually believed that a condition like endometriosis delivers you the poor oocyte. Many studies have looked at this, and it has been shown that although the number of eggs retrieved in patients with endometriosis could be less compared to the patient without such disease due to the reduced ovarian reserve following several surgical treatment for endometriosis, still, if you are able to retrieve eggs, the quality of the eggs do not decrease. That means, although your ovarian reserve is dropped, and if you are able to retrieve eggs from patients with endometriosis, still you are able to achieve successful pregnancies. In assisted reproduction, ovarian stimulation is done by different protocols, long down regulation protocol, short protocol, and the antagonist protocol, depending on the patient characteristics. The present study also looked at the relationship between the ovarian stimulation protocol and the success of frozen embryo transfer, and these differences in the success were not statistically significant, which again shows you, although you are able to use different protocols depending on patient characteristics, if you are able to retrieve eggs from these patients, you can achieve successful outcome. Similarly, the method of fertilization did not show any difference in terms of success. One of the important factors that is considered is whether the duration of freezing could affect your final outcome. That is to say, if you freeze embryos for 5 years or 10 years, will the result be less after an embryo transfer? We looked at the clinical pregnancy rates and the live birth rates depending on the duration of freezing. That is to say, whether the patients have transferred embryo after a short period of time or have they kept few months or years prior to embryo transfer. And it is important to observe that the duration of freezing, whether you freeze for 1 month or 10 months or 2 years, the final outcome following embryo transfer has not changed if you are able to successfully freeze and thaw those embryos. It is interesting to note, when we looked at the live birth rates, in fact, there is a statistically significant difference of duration of cryopreservation in favor of longer freezing. One of the explanations for this is because if you freeze for a longer period of time, that means you have retrieved the eggs and frozen the embryos when you are young. So somebody who is freezing embryos at 30 years wanted a replacement of embryo at 40 years of age. That means you are, although the woman is 40 years, your embryo that you are replacing is of a quality of a 30-year-old person. So that is one of the reasons that even if you want to postpone a pregnancy, retrieving eggs and freezing embryos at a younger age is a good thing. And now there is increasing tendency to freeze eggs, not embryos, for future use. Finally, we looked at, this is again quite short, that there are larger studies from the world to show that cryopreserved storage duration does not affect the postal survival, which is an important factor to consider. One of the final important factors is looking at the endometrium to see whether the endometrial thickness has an impact on the success of the frozen embryo transfer, because the endometrium plays a vital role in the implantation. When you look at the endometrium, it's generally most centers would not transfer an embryo if the endometrium is less than 6 millimeters. We looked at taking a cutoff of 8 millimeters to see whether the success rate would differ if the endometrium is less than 8 against an endometrium which is more than 8 millimeters. And it was noted that especially the clinical pregnancy rate, is shown on this side, has shown a statistically significant difference if you have a thicker endometrium of more than 8 millimeters. That is again, whatever the fertility treatment you do, that is one of the important factors to consider, the state of the endometrium when you replace an embryo, even when you do intrauterine insemination. In conclusion of this study, we were able to show that vitrification is a superior method of freezing compared to slow freezing method. The frozen embryo transfer outcome is comparable or even better following embryo transfer. You can achieve better clinical pregnancy rates and even live birth rates. It's a fact, very well known, that young age gives a better success rate. In this present analysis, the etiology of subfertility, the stimulation protocol, the method of fertilization did not show any significant impact on the success rate. And importantly, the duration of freezing did not show any negative effect on achieving a subsequent pregnancy. And it also revealed that endometrium is an important factor, and it is a fact that needs consideration prior to embryo transfer. Ladies and gentlemen, these results from the IVF center was achieved with untiring effort of many. It is teamwork of doctors, scientists, technicians, and nurses, where not a single person will not be able to do any of these things. So whatever I have presented today is efforts of a team of many. I would like to acknowledge, first of all, my parents who have shown me the way from the beginning of my life. Of course, I cannot forget Prof. Siva Chinnathamby, who actually have saved my life. Professor Harshraj Seniviratne, who has given leadership to in vitro fertilization industry in Sri Lanka from the inception. I would like to acknowledge you, sir, for the leadership and the guidance you have given to us. Dr. Minhan Bacha is a thank you very much for your efforts, and I would like to acknowledge your contribution to IVF in Sri Lanka as well. Dr. Sumedha Vidyaratna is the embryologist who has been the tower of strength in the center. At this moment, I must remember the Dr. Sarah Pujemana, who was a very kind-hearted member of our team, and we were very unfortunate to lose him. Ms. Manal Selgatna, Anuja Begre and Anuma Pereira, who have been anesthetists. Dr. Taranga and Sumitra are the IVF coordinators who have been. Vijita Ratmal and Dhammika, who are the support team for Embryology Lab. So all administrative staff and the laboratory and clinical staff at the Embryology Health Center. I would like to thank my teachers at faculty and school. Special word of thanks to Dr. Jordan Dutke and Alicia Solomon, who actually introduced me to IVF and who gave me the opportunity to practice in vitro fertilization in the United Kingdom. I would like to thank the senior registrars in subfertility, Dr. Udara and Inosha, for the data collection and, of course, voting in different ways. Mr. Suchar Suranga and Buddhika Mahesh and Dr. Chakra assisted in the statistical analysis. And I'd like to thank, of course, my sisters and brothers who have been encouraging me all the time to do what I'm doing today. There are several patients who have consented for use their photograph even in the presentation. And of course, without the patient, we wouldn't have been able to present any data here. I would like to thank all of them. My family, Surupika, Sandinandu, Dot Inga Mini, Dot Inga Pilini, and the baby make me. I would like to thank all of you for tolerating me with my busy schedule. And no oration will be successful without an audience. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for your presence today, and I would like to wish you a good evening. Thank you.